I'll cross that river and I'll fight life's final war with pain. Yeah.
share some of those reasons with you. Isaiah 43 is the first verse I want to share with you. It says this, "But now, this is what the Lord says, He who created you, Jacob, He who formed you, Israel, do not fear, for I have redeemed you. I have summoned you by name. You are mine." The Bible goes on to say, "When you pass through the waters, I'll be with you. When you pass the rivers, they will not sweep over you. When you walk through the fire, you will not be burned. The flames will not set you ablaze. I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior." Then he says this in verse 4. "Since you are precious and honored in my sight, because I love you, I will give people in exchange for you, nations in exchange for your life. Do not be afraid, for I am with you." As I look through Isaiah, consistently I hear, "Don't be afraid, don't be afraid, don't be afraid." And I can't help but think that when my grandchildren or my children were at home, when they're afraid, guess where they went? They went to their dad. I'm not going to ask how old some of you are today, but I'm assuming no matter what age, you still experience fear. Yep, you do. And so from what I hear in God's Word in Isaiah 43, I'm in Isaiah 44 starting this morning, I hear consistently, "Do not be afraid, do not be afraid." And do you know how my children and grandchildren stopped from being afraid? They just sat with me. So I want to encourage you. Don't let fear take you. Don't let fear take you. Go to your dad and sit with him. Just sit with him. God, we love you, and it does seem like anymore there's so many things that flood our minds that want to make us afraid, fearful, not liking what we're seeing on the news, our neighbors, at the gas pump, in the grocery store. There's just so many things, Lord, that would have us be afraid of what's perhaps coming next. So God, like a small child, you ask us to have faith like a small child. Help us to consider you as our dad. We're not always have good experiences with dads, but you are the dad that helps us face every day of our life. And as we spend time with you, we get to truly see what a dad's really like. So Lord, help us as people of all ages just sit with you on a daily basis, quietly, just spending time with you. Because I know, Lord, that as we do so, that fear of all these things that I just mentioned will just go away. Just go away. Thank you, Lord. Pray this in your name. Hey, Romans 8, we're hanging out today, kids. Hey, go to Romans 8, you got your Bible. So I got a thought for you. I thought I'm going to run by you. I asked a similar question a number of years ago when I was helping out at a church on Sunday nights. The thought I want to run by you: What comes to your mind? What's the first thing that comes to your mind when I say this phrase? You need help.
You're right.
That's a good one. That's a good one. A number of years ago when I posed that question, I think there's three options then. There's three options. There's like, nope, I don't need anyone to help me. And I find that a lot of times happens. When, for example, when I ask people how I can pray for them, people will say, nope, I don't need any help, I'm good. I'm thinking, wow, that's amazing. And then there's some people that will say, I sure do. Thanks, Rick, for that volunteer. I appreciate that. I sure do. But one time years ago, I said something like that in the church I was preaching at on Sunday night, and a gal in the audience said, "Back at you, preacher, back at you." And so there's kind of three responses: "Back at you, preacher," "I sure do," or "Nope, I'm not needing any help at all." As I contemplate this reality of you, I think one of the best qualities that we can have as Christian people is humility. It's humility, humbleness, humility, humbleness. I'm mindful of a preacher who was announced to his congregation that he's going to be leaving the church, and as he's shaking hands, and the last day that he's preached at church, there's a little old lady that came by and walking out the door. She was weeping profusely. And she just said, "Things will never be the same. Things will never be the same." And he was almost flattered. He tried to console her and says, "Yeah, that's going to be okay. Don't worry. I'm confident that the Lord will bring a new pastor here that is better than me." And she continued to cry profusely. She says, "Yeah, well," she says, "that's what the last three pastors have said." Humility. Sometimes it just comes to us in ways we're not expecting. And sometimes humbleness is one of the best things we can have. One of my favorite characters in history is Abraham Lincoln. If you get a reading of Abraham Lincoln, he's a wonderful man. And in his cabinet, he had a man named Edwin Stanton. Edwin was not a very famous a fan of Abe Lincoln. And one of the president's cabinet members came to Abe Lincoln and said, "You know what, Edwin Stanton, who is on also a cabinet of the cabinet of President Lincoln, he says, he's called you a fool, Mr. President. Edwin Stanton has called you a fool." To which Mr. Lincoln replied, "Well, I must check into that, for I found that he is usually correct in his judgments." It takes humility and humbleness to understand some things. And so today, as you and I travel forward in Romans 8, we're going to find that I hope that you find in your heart a desire to be humble, a desire to have a sense of humility, a desire that says, "I want to do what would please the Lord." And so the Bible says that we can clearly humble ourselves. We can do that. We can humble ourselves. And as we humble ourselves, I want you to share with you something that I think Mr. Lincoln just shared with me. Now listen to this. I want to share with you something. And I think you'd be wise to think the same thing. I'm fully capable of being a jerk. Some people say amen. And I have been. I'm fully capable of being a jerk. And I have been. I'm fully capable of having a potty mouth and use bad language and cuss like a blue streak. I'm fully capable of that. I'm fully capable of dishonoring my wife and my God by having inappropriate thoughts or actions towards the opposite sex. I'm fully capable of worshiping or placing too much time in something or someone that isn't the one true God. Friends, I say these things because I recognize that I need help. Anybody else need help? Wants me to be. That's what I want to be. I want to be a person that God wants me to be. Catch your Bibles, look at Romans 8, verse 4. You're going to find a passage there. It's quite powerful for us as we move forward here. I'm going to start in verse 3 first. It says this: "For what the law," this is verse 3, "what the law was powerless to do because it was weakened by the flesh, God did by sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh to be a sin offering." And so he condemned sin in the flesh. Folks, last week's message was powerful on how to explain that verse. I just want to encourage you to go back on YouTube or on Facebook. You can pick up that message. It also says this: "In order that the righteousness requirement of the law," this is verse 4, "in order that the righteousness requirement of the law might be fully met in" who? Us. That's Christians. Those who profess a love for Jesus Christ and have faith in him. Who do not live according to the flesh, but according to who? According to the Spirit. And so as I read that verse, here's what I hear Paul saying. And we're going to expand more than just a little bit. Paul's saying there's a requirement that God has for all of us. God has a requirement for all of us in our relationship with him. God requires that all of us be right with him through his word. He requires that. He requires that. So unless you and I follow God's law completely, being obedient to God's law, we will not be right with God. We won't be righteous with God. We won't be right with God unless we're obeying God's law. Now, if you've been paying attention the past two sermons, like, "Wait a minute, preacher. I thought you just said I was free from the law the past two Sundays." I thought you just said that. I did. We have been set free from the law of God because we all know that none of us can fully obey who? We can't fully obey God. We don't do it. We want to, but we don't. We can't do it. And so all of us sin against God by breaking His word as we are in relationship with Him. So then how can God do that? How can God expect you and I to follow His word completely in order to have a rightness with Him or a righteousness with Him? And remember, I only know one person who's perfect. And you didn't see Him in the mirror this morning. Who's perfect? It's Jesus. He's the only one that's perfect because He's never broke what? He's never broke God's law. So here's a thought. That is, when you and I place faith in Jesus Christ, who's never broken the law, that means because Jesus is sinless, and because I have faith in Jesus Christ, I too am what? I'm sinless before God. Okay, just as if I've never sinned. That's justification. And so when you're immersed into Christ, your sins are washed away, you receive the gift of the Holy Spirit, the Holy Spirit's presence inside you proves that you are a sinless person before God. But you may be asking the question when you read that verse 4. Wait a minute. How can I fulfill the requirement that God expects me to follow His word? How can I do that? How can God expect that of me to fulfill the requirement of the law according to His word, to be righteous? How can He expect me to fulfill that? Well, if you have your sermon outline today, it's in your bulletin. We're going to figure that out. So here's what we're going to find and figure out. The Holy Spirit's going to work in our lives in such a way that He's going to do that. So God expects, just back up for a minute, God requires all of us to write with Him based on His word. So how can I do that? How can I do that? Here's how we're going to do it. We're going to figure this out here. The Holy Spirit works in me to meet the requirements of the law, which is God's word. The Holy Spirit works in me. The Holy Spirit works in me to meet the requirement of the law, which is God's word. I'm going back to Romans 8, verse 4. Romans 8, verse 4. Look what it says again. In order that the righteousness requirement of the law, remember, the righteousness requirement of the law means obedience. Listen to this. Might be fully met in who? Says us. What are you talking about? God's going to fulfill the righteous requirement of the law in us. When I can't even brush my teeth and look in the mirror at the same time without falling over. I can't do those things. How can God expect that? Well, we're going to get that when we read verse 8:4. Who do not live according to the flesh, but according to the what? Who? According to the Spirit. So the Holy Spirit's a critical part of our life as a Christian to live in such a way that we fulfill the requirement of the law. I have a friend of mine. His name is Ronnie. Great friend of mine. Years ago, he was diagnosed with a disease called scleroderma. Have you ever heard of the word scleroderma before? Disease scleroderma? Scleroderma is a unique disease process. What happens in scleroderma is that you have, your body produces an excess amount of collagen. And as you get older, you know how important collagen is, right? Because that's why my brother would say to my grandma, Horace, who's 102, grandma, you need oilable legs. Collagen just stops producing when you get older, but scleroderma is just the opposite. Collagen actually gets produced more. And so as you think about it, I'll show you an image of scleroderma on the screen. This is how scleroderma affects your body. It's caused by excess collagen that leads to thickening and tightening of skin. So if you ever see someone with scleroderma, their skin gets really tight because they have pockets of collagen that are forming on their skin. And it can also affect the internal organs, lungs, your GI, your heart, your kidneys. Raynaud's syndrome is an early symptom of scleroderma. There's no cure for it. And so what's interesting about it, just to give you an idea, my friend who has it, literally parts of his skin is rock hard. Just part. Because he's produced too much collagen. And as that scleroderma can affect your internal organs, it can affect your organs in such a way that your heart has less contractility. Your vessels become hard. Your blood pressure getting really high. And so if you ever look up images of it, you'll see these people almost have stone-like faces, stone-like skin. You say, what's this got to do with this preacher? Well, I want to show you something. I want to show you two phrases. I want you to help me understand the difference in the two phrases. Okay? Here's phrase number one. I get to follow God's word to please God. I get to follow God's word to please God. Here's a second phrase. I have to follow God's word to please God. I have to follow God's word to please God. As you look at the difference between those two phrases, what's in the tone, Rick? It's attitude. That's exactly right. It's the attitude. You see, your attitude is all there is a difference in those two phrases. Okay? So if you think about this, like a scleroderma, someone with a spiritually hard heart, someone with a spiritually hard heart, like someone who's clinically afflicted with scleroderma, someone with a spiritually hard heart, which phrase they can't about? I have to. That's a spiritually hard heart. But someone with a soft, supple heart, open to God and His Word, says what? I get to read my Bible. I get to follow His Word. I get to go to church. I get to be in a Bible study. I get to all these things associated with the Church of Jesus Christ. And so how does an attitude get changed in a person's life? How does that happen? Well, if you got your Bibles, you can go there, but it's also on the screen. It's in Ezekiel 36, okay? Ezekiel 36. And when I get to this part right here, I will. Can you follow in with me at that point, okay? So you come in at that point, we get to that part of the, as I read this. I will give you a new heart and put a new spirit within you. And I will remove the heart of stone from your flesh and give you a heart of flesh. I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes. And you'll be careful to observe my ordinances. This is Ezekiel 36, verses 25 to 27. The presence of God's Holy Spirit does what to our heart? It changes it. It changes from a heart of stone to what? A heart of flesh. And we've learned that the flesh is bad, and the way the flesh responds, but God is also saying, use the flesh in a different connotation here. Look, we have a heart of stone here as an example, but our heart then becomes soft, supple. Like in scleroderma, if your heart gets hardened through that disease process, it's going to take your life. Spiritually, if your heart hardens, what's going to happen to your eternal life? It's going to take you. So the presence of God's Holy Spirit, look, I will put my spirit within you. The presence of God's Holy Spirit causes us to walk in God's statutes, meaning His Word. God says something, it causes us to want to do that. And so as you look at that passage, it's apparent to us that God has a desire. What is God's desire? Look, what does God desire? God's desire is to put His Spirit where? In your heart. That's His desire. Because God wants you to follow what? His statutes and observe His ordinances. And so as you and I think about this, the presence of God's Holy Spirit helps us to be carefully obedient to God's Word. Boy, when I was a kid growing up on the farm, my dad told me something. I wanted to be careful to do exactly what Dad told me to do. I wanted to. Difference was spanking versus Holy Spirit's presence, okay? So I really wanted to be careful to do what Dad wanted me to do. But with the help of the Holy Spirit, I want to walk and live the statutes of God. I want to walk in God's Word. I want to live in God's Word, as God's Holy Spirit does that. Friends, this is how the law of God and the requirement of God is met in us. So, well, what do you mean? Explain it. Listen. When God's Holy Spirit's inside you, your flesh, heart, and mind have changed. They've changed. They've been transformed. And you desire to follow the Holy Spirit in doing what God would have you do. Before you were changed, you could not and did not, and in fact, you were hostile to God's Word. Some of you have had this experience in your life. Before you had God's Holy Spirit in your life, what did you think of the Bible? Pain. The what? I saw a guy do communion meditation one time, and he just ripped pages out of the Bible. That's the way it was before you and I came to know Christ. But God's Holy Spirit changes us. And now we desire to do the very things that God has always desired for us, and we follow His Word, okay? So here we go. As we live according to the Spirit, that's what we want to do. As we live according to the Spirit and our obedience to the Spirit, the righteousness of God that He requires of us, His Word is fulfilled in us. We're actually doing the Word of God. That's what we're doing because we desire to do it. That's how He's fulfilling His righteousness in us. We're right with Him because the Holy Spirit has changed us in such a way that we desire, want to, and get to do the things that God commanded us. So what's that look like for you and I as we contemplate the reality of having the Spirit inside of us changed us? Here's what it looks like. Look, it's on your bulletin outline as well. The Holy Spirit works to me to require the law. Okay? How's he do that? Well, here's how we're going to work with the Holy Spirit. Thank God. Thank you. Friends, how often are you thanking God to make you righteous with him through the work of his Holy Spirit in you? Are you thanking him? Every day, waking up, thanking him. I'm just so thankful you have a plan to make me right with you through the Holy Spirit. Just so thankful. Just so thankful. Second thing is this, is repent from living according to the flesh. There are things right now, some of us, all of us, are doing the flesh, and we know we need to stop. It's time to stop. Make a decision today. I'm going to turn away from doing those things. I'm repenting. By the way, how easy is that? If it was easy, how many of us would do it well? It's not easy, but you have to do it. Because that's the Holy Spirit witness, convict us, we got to repent. Third thing is this, choose to listen to and be obedient to the Holy Spirit by your flesh. Choose to listen to and be obedient to the Holy Spirit by your flesh. There are things that your body wants you to do. My wife makes two desserts every Sunday, whether it doesn't matter who's at the house on two desserts every Sunday. Hey, you know what happens to me Monday through Friday? I have to listen to the Spirit and not eat one cake in one setting. Or listen to the Spirit and say, you know what, I'll feed it to you Tuesday morning. Point of fact is, when I'm talking about kids, I'm talking about my life, I'm more serious than that. But you have got to learn to listen and be obedient to the Holy Spirit, not you. As we contemplate the realities of Romans 8 as well, we're going to go on verses 5 through 8. And so as you think about that, Romans 8, 5 through 8, what does my life look like with the Holy Spirit? What does my life look like with the Holy Spirit? I want to read Romans 8, 5 through 8 here. Look what the Bible says. Those who live according to the flesh have their mind set where? On the things the flesh desires. But those who live in accordance with the Spirit have their mind set on who? The Spirit and what he desires. The mind governed by the flesh is what? Death. But the mind governed by who? The Spirit is life and peace. The mind governed by the flesh is hostile to God. It does not submit to God's law, nor can it do so. Verse 8, those who are in the realm of the flesh cannot please God. So, here we are, we're getting ready to go into June. Can you believe it's almost June already? You probably haven't done this, but I want to ask you something. If you could look back previous 6 months, now looking forward to the next 6 months, what do you think your top five priorities are? What do you think your top five priorities are? Got anything in mind? Top five priorities? Well, in January of 2022, the Pew Research Institute did a study on what people want for top priorities in 2022. Now, there's a bunch here, and if your vision is like mine, I can't read that on the right side very well. But I want to give you the top five priorities that came out of this year in January of 2022. Here's number one. Number one is this. Strengthen the economy. Strengthen the economy. Number two is this. Reduce healthcare costs. Three, deal with the coronavirus outbreak. Four, improving education. And five, securing social security. Now, as I look at that text, there's something that comes to my mind. I can relate to maybe one of those. Possibly two. Maybe one. How many can you relate to? Resonate to? None, maybe. Well, why do I say this? Well, I say this because I want to share with you something. I'm not the average U.S. adult. I am not the average American. And I would argue that neither are you. I'm not the average American, and you're not either. How come?
We're here.
That's right. We're at church on Sunday morning, right? Okay. That's a good start. Because, you see, I'm a Christian. I'm a Christian. Like I said, there's maybe one of those things on that top five that would kind of resonate with me. But I'm a Christian. And that means as a Christian, I have who indwelling inside me? The Holy Spirit. He's inside me. And that means my priorities look different than the average American. My priorities look different than the average American because the Holy Spirit, he indwells me. And so God placed his Holy Spirit inside the Christian for a reason. Okay? For a reason. God placed his Spirit inside the Christian so that Christian can be right with him to be in eternity with him. That's how come God put his Holy Spirit inside you. Now, if I look in verse 8 again, look what it says. Those who are in the realm of what? The flesh cannot what? Cannot please God. Now, Paul poses a pretty serious thought here. It's real serious. and helps us see the true priority for the Christian. That those who live according to the flesh, that follow fleshly desires, they just do what comes to their mind, they just do what pleases them. Those that follow the flesh, they cannot please God. But if we reverse engineer that verse, what about those who live according to the Spirit? What do they do? They please God. That's what they do. Friends, I want to share this. This is powerful. Don't lose this. Our number one priority as a Christian is to live every day of our life under the direction of the Holy Spirit to do what pleases God. That's our number one priority when I get up in a given day. Is to be obedient and live under the direction of the Holy Spirit so I can know how to please God. Do you realize how much freedom that is? When you get up in a day, the only person you have to please is who? God. And it's easy to do. It's easy to do because you're listening to someone who's telling you how to do it. Some of you wake up every day and you're trying to please how many people?
One.
Well, if you had your shoe cap, you could at least get to 20. How many people you can count? You're trying to please so many people. It's disgusting. It's just stressing me out. It's fretful. It's anxious. It's nerve-wracking. I mean, it's crazy how many people you're trying to please in a given day. And you're reactionary to relationships is based on that. But friend, you realize how freeing it is just to please one person. And not only are you pleasing that one person who's God, but God, in fact, is telling you through the Holy Spirit who's inside you how to exactly do that. And that's freedom to be able to be there. Well, so I'm not so convinced that we're supposed to please God like that's priority. Well, it is. Several times the New Testament tells us that. Okay? Look here on the screen. All right, Colossians 1:9-11. It says, we have not ceased to pray for you, and to ask that you may be filled with knowledge of his will, all spiritual wisdom and understanding, so that you will walk in a manner worthy of the Lord. Read the underline with me. To please him in all respects. Wow. Bearing fruit, doing good work, and increasing the knowledge of God. We are to please God in how many ways?
All
ways, all respects, okay? If I look at the next passage of Scripture, 1 Thessalonians 4:1, find then, brethren, we request and exhort you in the Lord Jesus, that as you receive from us instructions how to read with me, you ought to walk and please God. Very powerful of us. We're told to walk and please God. Hebrews 11:6, let's read together. And without faith, it is impossible to please him. Our life focus is to please God. And isn't it amazing that God puts his Holy Spirit inside of us so we can do exactly what? Know how to please God. That's amazing. You know, it's amazing to me also that when I think about people who view God, they think that God has set them up for failure. No, God has actually set you up for great success because he's allowed you to have someone inside you. And so when we think about things as far as Scripture goes and what the Lord would have of us, it's very apparent through Scripture that we are to learn what it means to please God. And so through the work of the Holy Spirit, he's encouraging you. He's changing your heart to have a desire to please him. And another way that I can look at this in my own life is this. Not only has the Holy Spirit proved I am sinless before God, think about this. But the Holy Spirit, think about this, but the Holy Spirit's continuing presence in my life helps me to sin less against God. Not only has the presence of the Holy Spirit convinced me and gives me great knowledge, knowing that I'm sinless before God, now his continuing presence as I walk through life helps me realize I am now sinning less before God. That means I'm pleasing him. He's encouraging me to do so. He's softened my heart in such a way where I get to study his word. I get to spend quiet time with him. And he's changed my heart to love him and to please him. And so think about this, friends. What does a life look like? What does a life look like whose heart has been softened by the Holy Spirit to sin less against God? Because they love God and want to please God. Well, look at verse 5. Those who live according to the flesh have their mind set on what the flesh desires, but those who live according to the Spirit have their mind set on what the Spirit desires. That Romans 8:5 passage is so powerful for us. It helps us understand something. That those who live according to the Holy Spirit have their mind set on the desires of the Holy Spirit. That's what they do. I had to tell you something years ago. When Avery was just a little girl, I'd go to town, pick her up at 8 o'clock, her mom or dad would go to work, and we'd watch her at our house here in Sheridan. And I'd pick her up at 8 o'clock, and the first thing we'd do,
First thing we did, we go to Sonic. And we pick up ice cream at 8 in the morning. It's a wonderful experience. I'd get her a cone, and I'd get me a vanilla dish. And what would happen was, I'd of course perceive it, and I wouldn't immediately hand her the cone. I'd scrape off the top of the cone and give her the cone, and I'd put the top of the cone in my vanilla dish. So I had double the ice cream. And I'm kind of curious, I haven't asked her, but she's old enough now. I'm kind of wondering, at what point did she realize that ice cream had a top? You know, I don't do that. And again, we're not talking about ice cream as far as desires. They're very serious desires. And food's one of them. There are very serious desires in life that we're listening to. And it's not good. We're listening to fleshly thoughts and feelings. Some of those associated with our stomach, and some associated with our thinking, our heart. But we're listening to things that we shouldn't do. And so it's readily apparent that we do that with food and lots of things. And so how do we get away from that? How does a Christian have spiritual thoughts? Because we're looking at how to live according to the Holy Spirit. How does it happen? Well, in Galatians 5:17. Let's read this together. The flesh desires what is contrary to the Spirit, and the Spirit what is contrary to the flesh. They are in conflict with each other, so that you are not able to do whatever you want. And so as you look at that text, friends, it's something we need to understand. Spiritual thinking means you realize you cannot do what who wants to do? Yourself. You can't do it. It comes that you have to start thinking that first. You know what? I've been doing what I want to do in so long, I don't know how to do different. Yeah, you do. You just heard it right now. It's time to start thinking differently. And so when you live in accordance with the Holy Spirit, it means that whatever you do, and whenever you do it, you are consulting with the Holy Spirit first and what He wants. That's who you're consulting with. I don't have time to do that. Yes, you do. But you don't understand, I just do things without thinking. That's probably part of the problem. You're only thinking about who? Yourself. You do have the ability to think, because God says you have ability to think and live according to the Holy Spirit. That means before you do something you want to do, you must consult with the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, is this what you want? Is this what you want me to do in this moment? And if you don't get an answer, what do you think you should do? Keep listening. Wait. Keep listening. And this means you're developing new habits. You say, I've never done that before. It doesn't matter. Develop a new habit. You develop new habits all the time. I guarantee 10 years ago, none of us had an iPhone. But we all have new habits of what? Looking at a phone. How about 60 years ago? Maybe longer than that. How many of us had TVs? Guess what we do now? I got to make sure I take a nap on the TV before I go to bed at night. We create habits all the time. You are fully capable of having a new habit of thought, which says, you know what, before I do something, I'm going to consult with the Holy Spirit and ask what He wants, what His desire is, because when I know what I do, what the Holy Spirit wants me to do, I'm going to please God. That's what's going to happen. You develop new habits of thinking. Romans 8, verse 7. Those who live according to the Holy Spirit have their mind set on being submissive to God's word. Look at Romans 8, verse 7. The mind governed by the flesh is hostile to God. It does not submit to God's law, nor can it do so. There was one time years ago, I was living in a house in Little Missouri, and I don't know what happened, but my mom was like sitting on a couch here, and our TV is right here, and the couch right here, and my mom's sitting here. And I was just a small person, probably first, second grade, and mom got after me about something. I don't know what she got after me about. It was well-deserved, I assure you. And so I tucked my head towards the couch like this, and I mimicked my mom. Like that. I didn't think she could see me. She saw me. Wow. I did not mimic my mother anymore after that. Did not do that. So let me ask you something. Two simple questions, and I'm going to ask, and this will tell me something about you. As a matter of fact, it will tell you about you. Whether or not the Holy Spirit is controlling your life. Two questions on whether or not you're letting the Holy Spirit control your life. Question number one is this. Do you believe think sometimes as Christians, we come to church, and I don't know why we don't bring Bible to church. Some we don't sometimes, but we have Bibles in church, obviously. But in this church, the Bible's going to be open. The reason it's open is because, well, I believe, personally, that the Bible is absolute truth, and every truth must be followed by me because I'm a follower of Jesus Christ, and the Holy Spirit helps me do that. And it is also that I'm going to submit these truths down in the Bible. I think many times as Christians, we're like my one-year-old self in that living room so many years ago. I was willing to listen to Mom's words, and I obeyed Mom's words, but in the background, I was sneering and mocking Mom's words. Because I didn't want to do it. Notice that. And so as I contemplate that reality with you, as you continue to listen to the Holy Spirit, you will sin less against God because you're being submissive to God's truths and His Word. That's what you will do. You see, you cannot read God's Word with black highlighter. You can't take out the things you don't like. You must follow how much of God's Word. And it doesn't take long. Think about this. For those of you who have small children and those of you that used to have small children, it doesn't take long to realize that when you're around a parent or you were a parent with a small child, that when a child is obedient to their parent, how pleasing is that relationship to that parent? It's very pleasing. When your children are obedient to you and your word, that relationship with your child is very pleasing. However, as a parent, when you've had a child be disruptive to you, or disobedient, it doesn't take long to recognize that that parent is severely strained for that child's disobedience. By the way, who's your dad again? God the Father. Jesus is your brother, and the Holy Spirit your counselor. And when you refuse to be obedient to those three people in your life, guess what's strained? Your relationship with all three of those people is very strained. Think about this. When you and I choose to set our minds on the desires of the Holy Spirit, we begin to experience a pleasing relationship with God. We'll say it again. When you and I choose to set our minds on the desires of the Holy Spirit, we get to experience a pleasing relationship with God. And the Bible describes that in Romans 8, verse 6. Look at there again. Romans 8, verse 6. The mind governed by the flesh is death, but the mind governed by the Spirit is what? Life and peace. How many here want life? Peace? Want peace? Yeah. Want peace, preacher. Are you done yet? Nope, not done yet. Peace. Life. Here's that. The Holy Spirit's presence. If you look at the Holy Spirit, He's amazing. As you look throughout Scripture, the Holy Spirit is always creating something. As a matter of fact, He was there in Genesis. It says the Holy Spirit hovered over the water, so He's involved in that creation process. We're going to read later in Romans 8, 11. He's in the creation process. The Holy Spirit is about creating life in us. And when you allow the Holy Spirit in your life, and you submit the Holy Spirit in your life, He takes the death out of our life and invites life into our life. Friends, I want life. And by listening to Him and being obedient to Him, I'm always going to have life in my life. Peace. You know how come we don't have peace? Because there's war. We had a chance to pray over Jeff and Deb's friend here about not too long ago, because she's from the Ukraine. And I saw tears in her eyes for them praying with her, because right now in her homeland, what is there? There's war. There's hostility between two warring countries. And don't you understand this? That when you and I have peace with God, it's because the hostility between us and God is stopped. Because through Jesus Christ and our faith in Him, we become sinless. And the Holy Spirit's presence in our life confirms we're sinless. And as we continue to listen to the Holy Spirit, we sin less against God. Which means we live a life that's no longer hostile to God. And when you stop listening to the Holy Spirit, you will grow in hostility to God. How many of you have seen someone who come to know Jesus Christ and then become hostile to God? Stop reading the Bible, stop going to church, stop going to Bible studies. What happened? They're listening to who? They're listening to the flesh, not the Holy Spirit. The presence of the Holy Spirit will always bring about peace in your life. And so as I contemplate this reality with you, there's something that's pretty encouraging to me. I must let my mind set itself on the desires of the Holy Spirit. And as I do that, I will continue to live in peace with God and have life. So if you follow along with your sermon, here it is. What does my life look like with the Holy Spirit? What does my life look like with the Holy Spirit? If your life looks like, repent and please yourself and others. Your prayer is to please God. But you don't understand. Nope. I do understand. We've all been guilty of pleasing ourselves and want to please other people. Priority in one life is to please who? Please God. How well will it work for us if our priority is pleasing God? I think it's going to work pretty well. Try it out. Really, seriously. Try it out. Stop trying to please everybody else. Stop trying to please yourself. Just please God. Try it out. Renew your thinking by asking the Holy Spirit what He desires. Every day, create new habits of thinking, new habits of thought. We've got to please the Holy Spirit. We've got to work with the Holy Spirit to find out what pleases God. We've got to do that. Renew your thinking. Start thinking differently. Start asking the Holy Spirit to help you think differently. Tomorrow morning is a great day. It's a day off, but Tuesday's coming. And so when you get up Tuesday morning, when you get up the day, ask the Holy Spirit, you know, Spirit, I want to do what you want to do. Third thing is this. Holy Spirit, the Scripture, asking God to show you any lack of submission. There's a reason we don't read the Bible. You know why? We don't like what's in it. Makes me uncomfortable. You know why it's uncomfortable? It's submission. I don't want to have to submit to everything. It's submission. So this week I had an opportunity to look at a study that my Lifeway research. Lifeway is a great company that I've used over the years of resources. And they worked with 1,200 Americans in September of 2020. 1,200 Americans in September 2020. They asked him three things. If you could reduce these three things, which one would give priority as far as reducing? Humiliation, wrongdoing, or anxiety. Humiliation, wrongdoing, or anxiety. So I'm going to ask this group. In this group, how many of you want to see a sense of decrease in humiliation or wrongdoing or anxiety? Which one would be the most prevalent in your mind? Wrongdoing, okay.
All
of
above.
All of above, good one. What else? Okay, well, if we look on what the bar graph that came up, that study, here's what came up. Of those 1,200 people on that September 2020, those 1,200 people, 46% said they would like to decrease their anxiety. 46%. Want to decrease my anxiety? 34% wanted to decrease my wrongdoing. And then 11% said they wanted to increase their humiliation. So based on where we just were at the sermon time, I got a question for you. Here's a thought I want to pose to you. Here it is. How much of our anxiety would decrease if we recognize that we're wrongdoing somewhere? I would submit that's an accurate argument, Jim. If we would recognize that we have wrongdoing somewhere in our life, the last sermon point was, are you in full submission to God's word? If you would recognize that you have wrongdoing in your life and you're doing something wrong, i.e. we call it sin. Wait a minute, I don't sin like everybody else. We're not talking about everybody else. We're talking about you. If you have anxiety in your life, I think it's wise to ask the question, God, is there somewhere I'm in sin against you? Humiliation. About the only time I ever found when I was humiliated is when what?
You got caught.
Got caught doing what?
Whatever.
Something wrong. How much of our humiliation would end if we would talk about our wrongdoing? I think all of it would. Now, I get it. This is a snapshot look at just three things. But these three things are powerful. I've never seen so much anxiety in our American culture than I have right now. And I just want you as a Christian to have heart different than everybody else. You have an indwelling of the Holy Spirit. I just wonder how many of us truly have sin going on, we're not addressing it, what comes out is, I'm a person who's anxious, and I'm a person who has a sense of humiliation. I'm embarrassed to be out in public. I have no confidence whatsoever. I just wonder how much it's due to wrong me. What's the solution? Repentance. Lord, I've got something going on. I can tell by my emotional context, I've got something going on. Okay, Jeff, you got something going on. Well, what do you need to repent of? I'm not sure. Great. Who can we ask? Holy Spirit. And what's He going to do? He's going to help you. And as you submit to the Holy Spirit and His Word, I know He'll point out somewhere in your life where you need to work on repentance. How many people need to repent? Everyone. Hey, let's stand up together. I want to sing this last song with you. It's called the Holy Spirit. I really appreciate it. share with you that if you have a desire to talk about your faith today after church, hey, look me up after church. I'll be somewhere there in the building. We can sit and talk for a good and have some time with someone, talk to another woman about what's got going on. I can connect these gals in church and help you there. Father, we love you. We give you praise for Jesus. It's so kind, Lord, that Jesus came here to save us from ourselves. Lord, it's very apparent that all of us need the Holy Spirit because that's exactly what you designed to happen, is for your Spirit to dwell inside of us. Lord, we must and we get to develop new habits of thinking because of your Spirit. We love you. Praise in your name.
Only 4 weeks, like just 1 month is all you. prayer for the family of Donna Spaulding. Donna is, she's been in the hospital and her organs have shut down. And they are taking her off of support today. So just be in prayer over that family. It's a rough time.
Donna's from Hopkins.
She's from Hopkins.
Yeah. I'll be praying for them. Thank you for mentioning that. Yeah, I have a friend and don't have attention to mention who it is, but they are having some very serious problems.
Yeah, it's a tough place, this whole world. Well, I just want to share with you on a positive note that we really do need teachers for these little kids, and it's really a good thing to teach those kids. And I've been told, and these probably prove this, there's 100% survival rate for teachers and shared Christian truth. You will make it. And they're great people. They're just great people. So I just encourage you to be a part of that. So I'm so glad to see you today. Good to see you. Thanks for coming.
Yeah.
Yeah.